Good morning, everyone. God has called us together today, and we welcome you, whether you're here in person or whether you're online. And a very special mention to all the ladies, whether you're a mother, an auntie, a cousin, a niece, you know, any special lady in your life is to be acknowledged today. We're looking forward to your message, Heath, The World We Choose, in our series on Genesis, and we're looking forward to hearing what you've got to share with us from God today. How wonderful it is to be together with our MCC church family, to worship together, to laugh together, and to cry together. We're so fortunate to have a family of strong believers who genuinely care for one another. So remember, before you go today, to share with someone, to share a smile, to share a hug, to share a story, because that's what we are, we're a family. Just wanted to say on that note, on behalf of our family, I want to thank you for your love and practical support and prayers that you're offering to God for Julianne. Julianne is appreciative and knows she is enveloped in the love and care of MCC family. That's just genuinely from the family. So the lyrics of our first song remind us that no matter what life throws at us, we know that God's love is greater. Hallelujah means God be praised. And this is a song to praise our God together. So stand up, sing loud, and praise.
Raise a hallelujah.
don't need to live our life on our own, in our own strength, because we are promised access to God, our Creator, and the Holy Spirit, who through Jesus paid all our debts.
Before we send the kids out, now downstairs we have our kids' activities. So anyone who's in, preschool up to high school, the leaders are just standing up the back there. So if you'd like to follow them, they're going to go out that door and downstairs. So if you haven't been before, just follow those guys if you'd like to do that. Whilst the kids are leaving, say good day to someone next to you. And we'll be back in just a moment. Right, we'll come back together again. Just want to bring a couple of things, interest here in the life of MCC. Again, there'll be morning tea after the service, so we'll have a bit more time to have a chat out in the hall there. So go grab a tea or a coffee out there, or if you're that way inclined, there's some barista coffee just in the cafe as well, if you'd like to have a crack there. A couple of things this week coming up in the life of our church. We've got lots of activities going on. You can find them in our bulletin, which you can access via the website. And also, just a reminder for the parents, the Kidscape is on this Friday night. I think it's a games night, so bring the kids up for that at 6 o'clock. And for those that call MCC their home, we've got a couple of things coming up to do with the revitalisation project that we're working on with City to City. So next Sunday, we're going to have a short briefing session after the church service, so that'll be about 11 o'clock. Come along and we'll be talking through the report we've received and the next steps from that. And then the following Sunday, which will be the 28th, there'll be another sort of Q&A time for that, give you a bit of time over the week to digest that, then come back together, ask some Q&A, and then for the members to approve that that report at a special meeting and to take the next steps. So again, this is described in the bulletin, but if you've got any questions, come and grab one of the leadership team and we'll talk you through that. I'm now going to pass over to Lynn, who's going to read the Bible and pray for us now. Thank you.
Good morning, church. It's so good to be here this morning, and what a privilege it is to be able to worship the Lord together and just to be able to pray to our Heavenly Father and just talk to Him about what's on our hearts and minds and know that He hears us. He hears every cry. So will you just join me as I pray this morning? Thank you, Heavenly Father. We just come to you in the name of Jesus, and we just thank you for your goodness this morning. We thank you that you are so real. You are so close to us. You are close to the brokenhearted. You are close to those who are grieving and hurting. And Lord, we just want to thank you that in your presence is fullness of joy. Lord, this morning I just want to lift up our pastors and Heath and Janine, Lord, as they lead this congregation. Lord, I pray you would guide them, give them wisdom. Lord, set them in the direction that you want them to go. I thank you that you lead them in the paths of righteousness for your name's sake, Lord. And as our pastor brings the word to us this morning, and we've been learning about how it all began in the beginning, Lord, how you created us and wanted us to be in communion with you, and how we as humanity made different choices, but that, Lord, you made a way for us to come back to you. I just pray that you will bless him as he brings the word to us this morning, that we would be able to understand. Lord, we just open up our ears and our hearts right now to hear and receive what you have for us this morning. And Lord, I just want to bless all the moms out there, no matter what their situation or circumstance is, Lord. I just pray that today they would know they are honored, not just by us, but by you, Lord. That is a privilege, Lord. And when we have children, you said children are a gift from the Lord. So when we bring gifts into this world, Lord, it is such an honor and blessing, and I just want to bless them this morning. And Heavenly Father, I know there's so many that are sick and hurting and dealing with all sorts of maybe illnesses and injuries in this body of believers this morning. So I just want to lift up Julianne and Michael and so many. I don't know all their names, but Lord, you know them. You knew each of them. You formed them when they were in their mother's womb. And Lord, I just claim your healing power just to come and just saturate them wherever they are right now. Just your presence to come, Lord. We stand on your word, and your word says that when two or three are gathered in your name, there you are in the midst of them. And whatever we ask for believing, we will receive it. So I thank you, Lord, that healing is the children's bread, and we just ask you to touch every life right now with your power and your presence, Holy Spirit, which is the same power that raised Jesus from the dead. Lord, I just thank you that you're with us. Lord, I just pray you bless everyone that came today. And maybe those that don't know you, that they would just feel a tug in their heart from you, Holy Spirit, that you will just reach out and bring them in, bring them to you, just gently and beautifully like you do. Thank you, Heavenly Father. Amen. And if you have your Bibles this morning, otherwise it's up on the screen, I believe, turn with me to Genesis chapter 3, and I'm going to read verses 1 to 24. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it or you will die." "You will not certainly die," the serpent said to the woman, "for God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened, and that you will be like God, knowing good and evil." When the woman saw the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man, "Where are you?" He answered, "I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid." And he said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat from?" The man said, "The woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree, and I ate it." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent deceived me, and I ate." So the Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock and all wild animals. You will crawl on your belly, and you will eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel." To the woman he said, "I will make your pains in childbearing very severe. With painful labor you will give birth to children. Your desire will be for your husband, and he will rule over you." To Adam he said, "Because you listened to your wife and ate fruit from the tree about which I commanded you, you must not eat from it, cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil you will eat fruit from it all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat the plants of the field by the sweat of your brow. You will eat your food until you return to the ground, since from it you were taken, for dust you are, and to dust you will return." Adam named his wife Eve because she would become the mother of all the living. The Lord God made garments of skin for Adam and his wife and clothed them. And the Lord God said, "The man has now become like one of us, knowing good and evil. He must not be allowed to reach out his hand and take also from the tree of life and eat and live forever." So the Lord God banished him from the Garden of Eden to work the ground from which he had been taken. After he drove the man out, he placed on the east side of the Garden of Eden cherubim and a flaming sword flashing back and forth to guard the way to the tree of life. Thank you.
Going to sing again before our message. We worship an amazing God who sacrificed all to save you and me, and this is amazing. It's amazing grace.
Who shakes a whole earth? Good morning, everyone. I was saying to a few people this morning that out of the passage we have today could be three or four sermons. I'm trying not to do them all, but hopefully we can get through in time for you to get to dinner with your parents, if that is the case. And I would also like to add my well wishes to all the mums and special ladies in our life, and thank you especially to the mums who are standing up here. Both of them have a daughter overseas at the moment, so that's pretty exciting for both of them. And some of you might not know Lynn. Lynn has a slight accent. It's not German. It's from Canada. And so her daughter got married last year in Canada. It's very exciting. And actually, one of her stepdaughters is getting her baby dedicated here in June. So that's going to be a great day. The church will be chock-a-block full with lots of people who all live in the area, and it's going to be a great time together. So happy Mother's Day, and I trust that you will be blessed and at least looked after for one day before you go back to looking after everyone else. As Janelle mentioned, today we're going to look at the world that we chose. We've looked at the God who made the world, and we've looked at the world that God made and how he made us. But the world that we live in doesn't look like Genesis 1 and 2. It looks a lot more like the rest of Scripture, which is full of amazing characters who are incredibly flawed. Those who love God and at the same time commit murder and adultery and lie and deceive. And they do all of the sort of things that you and I see each and every day. And the Bible's very realistic about the fact that there's something wrong with the world. And the question becomes, what is the problem with the world? And here is one place, at least in the movies, The Matrix, which was 96, so it's a long time ago now. And Morpheus, which literally means to transform, he says, what you know you can't explain, but you feel it. You've felt it your entire life. There's something wrong with the world. At some point or other, whether it was when we were very young or perhaps we were very amazingly blessed and didn't really feel it until we became a teenage angster, as I sometimes call them. There's something wrong with the world. It doesn't work like we think that it should. There's something wrong. What is the problem? Well, no one's really sure, I think, because there seems to be so many different answers to the question about how you might fix the world. And not surprisingly, they're really based on how we see ourselves. And last week we looked at a couple of options about what people see about themselves. One was we see ourselves as our thoughts. Not surprisingly, many people will say that the solution to the world's problem is to change those thoughts, and the best way to do that is through education. Education will solve the problems of the world. When teenage boys are hassling teenage girls, or sexual harassment in the workplace, or domestic violences in the secrecy of homes. If we want those things to fall down and to diminish and ultimately to disappear altogether, we need education. We need to explain that these things are wrong to the men who've grown up in those kind of cultures and for them to actually change their mind through education. But it still happens. There's been a lot of education. Some of us, or some people I should say, see human beings as simply relationships. And if it's relationships, then the answer is to change the nature of those relationships. Not necessarily on an individual level, but certainly on a social level. So that those who are in relation to those who are rich, who are poor, they need to be lifted up and the rich need to be brought down. And there's a whole lot of answers that are given about how we could restructure society, and the way we do that at the moment is either through revolution or through legislation. If we're not going to have a revolution from the bottom to the top, then we're going to have legislation that comes to lift up those who are below. And of course, for those of us who think, or those of us who might think, that humanity are just animals, then how do you actually change animals? Well, there's a couple of ways, and none of them are good, but basically, the easiest thing to do is to say that some of the animals are less evolved than the others. And so they become a lesser and therefore unimportant and ultimately can be extinguished altogether. And we've seen that through the history of the world, people trying to change the way the world is by eliminating a people, a culture, a race, a number of folks who disagree with who they are and what they're doing. And lastly, of course, there are those who see us simply as machines. And the answer to the world's problems is to increase productivity and efficiency. Now, if that blows up the machines, well, so be it. But they're the solutions to the world's problems. We can have education, social infrastructure, legislation, all of these things. We can even do discrimination if we have to, but none of them work. And we still feel there's something wrong with the world. What is it? Well, the Bible has a pretty simple answer. It's three letters. It's sin. And at the end of Genesis 2, we have this beautiful picture of God and his creation, the created order and his people. And we have Adam telling us how beautiful his wife is. She's bone of bones and flesh of flesh. She'll be called woman, for she was taken out of man. He's gone to writing romantic poetry as soon as he meets her, which is pretty exciting. God, the world, and us in perfect harmony. And there's this beautiful picture a little bit later that comes in retrospect where it says that God was walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and the picture seems to be that the relationship between God and us was so close, so intimate, so personal that we could walk side by side and discuss the day, whatever that might have been. And that's not how it is now, of course, because of that three-letter word that a lot of people don't like, but the word is sin. How did it enter the world? Because it wasn't there at the end of chapter 2. Well, we're told how it enters the world. It comes through the serpent, who was more crafty, verse 1, than any of the wild animals the Lord God made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" And the woman said to the serpent, "Well, we can eat fruit from the trees of the garden, but God did say you must not eat from the tree that's in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die." What happened that sin would enter the world? We're told here that the fundamental reason for why sin entered the world is because we did not trust God. See, when God tells us about what we can eat, he says it in a very different way. He says, "All the beasts, everything that I've made, everything is for you." The devil says, "Did God say nothing is for you?" The doubt that's planted as a seed in the mind of us is that God is not good. Because if he was good, why would he put restrictions on you? Ultimately, we don't believe who God is. We don't believe that he loves us. We don't believe he has our best interests at heart. We don't believe that his way of life is the way of life. And so as it unfolds, the serpent suggests God doesn't want you to be any better than you are. He wants to keep you down. He wants to keep you low. Don't trust him. He doesn't love you. He isn't for you. Even though they've just been told that everything that God made is for you and that God himself is walking with them, still they believe the lie. We believe the lie that God isn't good, that God doesn't have my interests at heart, that God doesn't actually love me. And the alternative that the serpent gives is, instead of having God telling you what to do and God making restrictions on you, why don't you become like God? "You won't certainly die," the serpent said to the woman, verse 4. "For God knows when you eat from the tree, your eyes will be opened and you'll be like God, knowing good and evil." What does it mean to know good and evil? That's the promise. That's the promise that the serpent makes. And that's the promise that tips Adam and Eve humanity over the edge and into sin. Well, there's a word for it that we could use, which I kind of like. It's the word autonomy. What the devil is offering here, what the serpent is saying, when he says that you will know good and evil, he's not saying that you will be able to tell the difference between good and evil as God has made it. God is the one alone who tells us what is good and what is evil. But when it says to know good and evil, it means to count as good or evil. So if I have an action, I don't care what God says. He's not the boss of me. If I say that it's good, then it's good for me. And if it's bad, it's bad for me. That was the offer that was given to humanity. And so a great definition that I found over these last weeks is the definition of sin is autonomy. What does that mean? It means to rule myself. We become the judge of what counts as good and evil, even though we still don't decide what is good or evil. So no matter our culture, our circumstance, our history, our tradition, our cultural tale that's thousands of years long for each of us, we might think we know what God is, what is good or evil according to us, but we aren't the ones who defined it. God is the one who defines what good and evil is. We move the goalposts, change the categories so that we feel so much better about ourselves. What does autonomy look and sound like? Well, this poem, Invictus, 1888, is a perfect picture of what it is. So I'm going to try and read it to you, but let's look at what it feels like to have autonomy, to be in charge. Out of the night that covers me, black as the pit from pole to pole, I thank whatever gods may be for my unconquerable soul. In the fell clutch of circumstance, I have not winced nor cried aloud. Under the bludgeonings of chance, my head is bloody but unbowed. Beyond this place of wrath and tears looms but the horror of the shade, and yet the menace of the years finds and shall find me unafraid. It matters not how straight the gate, how charged with punishments the scroll, I am the master of my fate, and I am the captain of my soul. That's what it means to live in autonomy. That's what it means to live as a sinner. We don't care what gods think. We can't be conquered. We see everything that happens as either circumstance or chance. And we're hurt, but we're not going to bow down. And the world, if we look at it, is simply a world of wrath and tears. And the only thing to come is just this horror of the shade. There's this looming death, which we tend to forget about. And no matter how old this man gets, he says, I am not going to be afraid of dying, because he says, I don't care how straight the gate, I don't care how narrow other people tell me I have to be accepted, and I don't care what it says about the punishments. He's the one. I'm the one who decides whether my life is valuable. I'm the one who decides whether my life has been good or bad. That is what sin is. It's not a set of activities. It's not just certain things that we don't like. It's actually setting up our entire life against God, refusing to love him, refusing to believe in him, and instead being the one who makes the choices for me. And if there's a place that you can find that, welcome to Sydney, Australia. I don't know how many times I've heard in these last few years people say things like, you just do you, I'll do me. Do whatever makes you happy. Make sure you feel like you're the one that's in charge of your life. Don't let anyone tell you what to do. Have you heard these things too? You see, our culture, and it's a fiction, is not that we can make some choices, but that we have to. We are the ones who have to decide what is right and wrong. We are the ones who have all of the control. And it's in the isolation of our private selves. In other words, even though we know there's something wrong with the world, our culture says, well, just live with it. You work it out for you, I'll work it out for me, and we'll all work it out together. And that's one of the reasons why sin is still the one who holds our world to ransom. So what are the results? If that's what sin is, if it's autonomy, if it's living for the self, if it's making self the ruler of my life, what are the results? Well, one is alienation. We see that. We see the separation of Adam and Eve, the woman and the man, from themselves, verse 7. We see that they're naked and they hid and they had to put on fig leaves and they covered themselves. They hid from each other. That's the first alienation between people. The second is that God himself is alienated from us. He's the one who says, you've moved away from me. Why have you believed a lie? You've done something that I told you not to do. We're estranged from God, but he's estranged from us and angry. And we're estranged from God. We want to hide. We want to hide from each other again. And we particularly want to blame the people who are around us. But just to go through the rest, we are from our bodies, we're alienated. Childbearing, very severe. And I know I always make light of how hard childbearing was, because Janine, when my wife, didn't make any noise in the first pregnancy, so I figured it was easy. In fact, the nurses were alarmed. They said, are you okay? And she went, I'm fine, I'm just concentrating. I know that's not true for everyone, and certainly wasn't true for numbers 2 and 3. But we are alienated, even from our bodies, the way they ought to work. They betray us. Just hearing about our wonderful brother, Michael Gledson, this morning. His leg betrays him. It's a picture of alienation. And of course, we're actually alienated from the very world that we're a part of. It says, the ground is now cursed. You'll have to work really, really hard all the days of your life, and it will give you nothing. This is alienation from ourselves, from God, God from us, from each other, from our very bodies, and even from creation, and even creation itself is splitting apart. It is meant to produce, God said, the plants of the field that are good for food, and even itself is already decaying. Thorns and thistles. Alienation is one of those things. And that should be no surprise to any of us. If sin is self-rule, then of course we can't have anybody else impact our decision-making or who we are. So of course we're going to be alienated. But no one wants to be alienated. People want community. They want connection. They want, as we said last week, shalom. They want that flourishing of life in all its forms and in all its ways, its relationship. Second, a word that's actually not really allowed to be used much anymore, shame. The second result. Not only alienated, but now we're shame. We have this desire to hide ourselves. Even though we're the ones who make ourselves, we don't really show the true person. Isn't that an irony that we're the ones who decide who we are, and yet at the same time we never show people who we are? Shame. I was naked. There's nothing that stops God from seeing who we really are. And so we hide. We hide from God. And we hide from each other. And to be honest, we often hide from ourselves. Just don't want to think about that right now. Shame. And of course, blame. Isn't it amazing that Adam goes from saying, this woman is incredible. She's the one who has bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh, and we're going to go and we're going to become one, and we're going to be an amazing people. And then what happens after that? Well, when Adam is asked, why did you do what you did? What's his answer? This is great because he's pointing his finger in two directions at once. This is what he says. The woman, so it's her fault, you put here, and it's yours. Okay, it's not me, it's them. It's the woman there, and it's you. You're the one who did this, God, and she's the one who did it. How good are we at blaming others for our own faults? How good are we? See, we're not only ashamed of ourselves, but how even it's so much better to shift that shame to another person and blame them. And as Alexander Solzhenitsyn says, someone who lived through the gulag in Russia and spoke at the UN and to the US Parliament, and they couldn't believe that people would be treated so badly until he showed them his scars. But this is one of the things that he said. He said, if only it was so simple. He said it in Russian, this is English. If only there were evil people somewhere insidiously committing evil deeds, and it were necessary only to separate them from the rest of us and destroy them. But the line dividing good and evil cuts through the heart of every human being. And who is willing to destroy a piece of his own heart? Wouldn't it be great to always think it's someone else's fault? They're the ones who should pay for what's happening to me. We are alienated from each other and from God and from creation. We feel shame because we don't want anyone to know who we really are. We don't want to live naked. We want to blame everyone else. It's their fault. And of course, there are then power plays. If I'm going to be the best version of me and you're going to be the best version of you, what happens when our two versions of who we want to be clash? Someone has to win. Someone has to be the one who comes out on top. And so our whole life is this power play, and it's particularly seen within the bounds of a home. Anyone who's ever lived in a home with siblings and parents knows that it's really a battlefield, right? It's just like, no prisoners, let's just make this happen. And so we hear about that. We hear not just about the difficulties of childbirth and the way that we're even alienated from our own bodies, but it says, your desire will be for your husband and he will rule over you. There is now a power play. After God had blessed the man and the woman and had said, go out, multiply, fill the earth, subdue them, he'd given this incredible command, an incredible way of saying, this is what we're going to be doing for the rest of your lives. Now it becomes, I want to do what I want to do for me. And if that means having to push you out of the place of number one, then I am willing to do it. In fact, I have to. Otherwise, how can I be number one? Self-centered power plays, particularly seen within the boundaries of a home. And finally, exile. At the end of the story, we hear that God banishes, verse 23, Adam and Eve from the garden to work the ground from which he'd been taken. He drove the man out. He placed on the east side of the Garden of Eden cherubim and a flaming sword flashing back and forth to guard the way to the tree of life. We're alienated. We're shame. There's blame. There's power plays. And there's exile. We don't feel like we're where we should be. We don't feel like we're in where we should be. That's the world that you and I are living in. And it's all pretty bleak and awful, but it's not the last word the Bible has. And even within all of this incredible pronouncement of judgment upon sin, where sin is to actually choose myself to know what is right and wrong, and not to believe God, not to think that he is good, not to think that he loves me and that he has my best interest, but only I can decide that. Even in the midst of all of that, God has something to say that gives us just a bit of hope. But before we get to the hope, let's wallow, but that sounds terrible, and it is terrible, but let's just sit with the fact that this is who we made us to be. You know, it's often quoted, but no one can find where it's written. But G.K. Chesterton is said to have written a letter to Time magazine, who had What's Wrong with the World as their title. And the answer that G.K. Chesterton said, in regards to your question, what is wrong with the world? The answer is, I am. Yours sincerely. We're the ones who've made this world the way it is. We're the ones who continue on being alienated. We're the ones who feel the shame and push blame upon others and power play. We're the ones who feel out of place from where we ought to be, exiled. That's not God. We have a picture of what God had for us, a place of blessing and multiplication and an amazing place where the whole world is to be changed into a garden city, beginning from Eden and moving out, using all of the things that God has given us to bring incredible care and help and amazing things that you and I enjoy to life. What's wrong with the world? We are. But it's not the last word. Even in the midst of this, there is the beginning of hope. And so as you and I work in the world, as we live in the world, as we eat and we chat with people, as we spend our time with others, knowing that the alienation and the shame and the blame, and they're all happening at once and sometimes even against each other for that. As people who believe that God is good and who loves us, Genesis 1-3 tells us that the way the world is not our future. This is not our future. This is not how it will always be. But even more importantly, perhaps, it's not the way it was. When we feel that there's something wrong with the world, the answer is yes, there is. We broke it. It's not the way that God made it. And that makes all the difference when we're talking to people who say, well, God's done this and God's done that. And if God just showed me everything that I wanted to know, then I would be willing to believe in him. That's what autonomy looks like. I get to choose whether God's the God I want or not. I get to choose. If it fulfills me and makes me feel happy, then I'll take on God. But this is not the way we were meant to be. That feeling, that dislocation, the alienation in our minds, in our hearts, in our relationships, that's not how it was. That's just the beginning of hope, because if there was a time when it wasn't like this, is there a possibility that perhaps for the future it could be back to how it used to be or how it was meant to be? And the answer is yes, but there's only just a couple of little glimpses of hope, like this little plant trying to live inside a concrete slab. Three things that happen. Number one, God promises. He says to the serpent, I will put enmity between you and the woman and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head and you will strike his heel. God promises there will be a day of reckoning for this serpent. He will have his head crushed, but it won't come without pain and suffering to the one who crushes him. That's why sometimes it says strike his heel, as in snake bite, or sometimes it says to bruise the heel. Anyone who's had a bruised heel knows it's painful, but it's not the end of you. That's a promise that God makes. Sometime in the distant future, the offspring of Adam and Eve are going to produce someone who will bring a reckoning on the one who tore it down. That's number one. The second thing is, despite just being told that everything is out of sync, Adam still names his wife Eve, and the word literally is life. He names his wife life. He knows that even though God said, if you eat this fruit, you will die, it's not straight away, it's not instant, it's delayed. And in the midst of all of that curse upon the ground and upon the activities that Adam and Eve do, they're personally not cursed. It's their activities that they're doing that are cursed. Life still continues. It's just this tiny seed of hope that Adam and Eve, obviously not knowing really much more than what they've experienced so far, they know that life's to continue in some way. It's just this little seed. And then, of course, at verse 21, it says that the Lord God made garments of skin for Adam and his wife and clothed them. By clothing them with skin like this, God is covering their shame. He's hiding who they were and are. God's the one who provides it. And out of this, we can start to see how God might bring about a change. Something will have to shed its blood and it'll have to die in order for this provision to happen. This is the first death in the Bible. These animals who were sacrificed to give a covering for God's people. And the reason that God does that is we need a better covering than fig leaves. I wanted to find a piece of art that has been done where the fig leaves cover everything. Confession, I couldn't find one. At least not that was not a cartoon. They're terrible. Terrible coverings. They don't work. We need something better, and God provides this for us. But we also need a better atonement, because the word atonement literally means to cover, which is why it calls the Ark of the Covenant, the bit on the top, the atonement cover. It's kind of a double naming, but it means literally a cover seat. It's something that goes over us that will protect us and keep us safe. They're the promises that God says someone's going to come and he provides a covering and life will go on. And we know, if we've been in church for any length of time, that Jesus is the answer to the promise. He's also the answer to how God will provide. How is God going to cover us? How is God going to stop us from facing the judgment that we so rightly deserve for turning our back on him and calling him not good and not loving, not powerful, not interested God? Well, Adam and Jesus are contrasted in Romans chapter 5. So let me read just the two verses. It says, "Consequently, just as one trespass resulted in condemnation for all people, so also one righteous act resulted in justification and life for all people. For just as through the disobedience of the one man the many were made sinners, so also through the obedience of the one man the many will be made righteous." Adam here, pictured as the one who stepped over, that's what it means to trespass, to step over the line. That resulted in our condemnation. If we are anything like Adam, which is another way of saying, if we are human, then we are condemned with him. It's for all people. No one escapes the condemnation that comes through what Adam and Eve did. But there's the promise. There's one righteous act. There's one stomping on a head, to use Genesis language, that brings justification and life. It's Jesus. Jesus' one righteous act. What act is it talking about? It's talking about the act where Jesus was crucified, where he gave himself over and handed over by those who wanted to get rid of him. He shed his blood. As the chief priest said, it's better for one person to take the blame than for the whole nation to perish. Jesus crucified naked so that we could be clothed. He bore our shame so that we could be honored. Jesus alienated from his Father. Do you know there's only one time when Jesus calls God, God instead of Father? It's on the cross when he quotes Psalm 22 and he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? The only time. Why? Because he's alienated for the very first time in all eternity from his Father as the Son. Jesus experienced all of those things so that we might be able to have life. And it was his obedience that makes us righteous. Jesus is the one who covered our sin, who stomped on the serpent, who was bruised for our transgressions. It's why each time we come, we want to worship him and love him and trust him. He is the reason that we have a chance to trust God again, to trust that God really is good. We look at the cross. We want to know that God really loves us. We look at the cross. We know that God can be trusted, yes, because here he is fulfilling his promises that he made even at the very beginning in the cross. The God whom we worship is not distant or far off. He's not indifferent to our pain. He's not far away and uninterested. He's not belittling us. He's not pushing things around to make our life hard. We're doing all of those things. He is reaching out and offering life to all and righteousness because of Jesus and his death on the cross. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we go through Genesis 3, there are so many other things that I guess we could focus on. But at the end of our time here, help us to focus on Jesus. We know there's something wrong with the world. And if we're honest, we know it's us, each one of us. We know that we need a Savior. We need someone to cover our shame, someone who will take our blame, someone who's willing to be alienated so that we can be restored into relationship. And we thank you for Jesus. Help us to look to him. Whenever we doubt that you love us, help us look to Jesus, who loved us to the end. When we doubt that you are good, help us look to Jesus, whose goodness was sacrificed so that we could be made whole. Father, as we continue the life that we have here, we know there's also a future to be had, a future where these things will be changed forever. Help us to live with the incredible realism that comes from knowing what's wrong with the world, but also with the incredible hope that comes from knowing that Jesus has risen from the dead and that one day we too will be raised with him and creation itself will be renewed just as we are each day. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Heath, for elaborating on that passage and helping us to understand more about what we choose in this life. I'm just going to sing our last song now. Stand and sing with us. Oh, praise the name. See his wounds, his hands, his feet.
Well, indeed, we do get to praise the name of the one who saved us and who brought us into life. We have morning tea, and I know a lot of you might need to rush off and go and see mums and daughters and sisters and aunties along with the rest of the family. I hope you have a wonderful time with family this afternoon. Also, realizing that some may be estranged from families and it's actually a very difficult day, we want to pray for you before we head out. But don't forget, let's enjoy morning tea together. Share what God is doing. Let's pray. Father, what a wonderful way to conclude our service, to remember that it will be a day of forever praise, the day when the world is set right. We thank you and praise you for Jesus, for all that he did, for all that he said, for all that he has done and will do. May he overflow from our hearts into the hearts and lives of those around us. And particularly this afternoon, for us to spend time with family, for many a very cherished blessing, perhaps not as often as we like, but to honour those amongst us who have been mums, to honour those who have been special aunties and sisters to us all. But Father, we also pray for those who, for whom this is a very difficult day, maybe having lost mum recently or estranged from children. Whatever the reason may you bring peace and comfort. May you be the one who lifts them up and draws them into your loving arms. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. See you at morning tea.